Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. We're going to start things off with a song by Micah Tyler, and it's called Even Then. Again, we are having some slide issues, so we don't have the words up for you, but if you want to check out the bulletin and the e-news, you can find the words there.
Up in the out of the garden project. So we hope that when you are out and about, that you can drop by and help support these wonderful organizations. Those are all of my announcements that I wanted to bring to your attention today. And as we usually do, we have a centering quote to kind of get us in the mindset of worship, to kind of get us in the idea of what our theme for the day is going to be. And we have a quote today from C.S. Lewis. Relying on God has to begin all over again every day as if nothing had yet been done. We consciously choose when we wake up in the morning to put our faith and our hope and our trust in God. God who has shown us and told us time after time that God will be there for us in whatever we face that day. We know that this God is bigger than any of our problems and situations that we face. And we must choose daily to continue to rely on this God who loves us beyond love. So I want you to think about how sometimes we want to trust ourselves, or we put our hope in other people and other things, when really we need to rely on God, who is there no matter what. Think about that. We'll have some quiet music, then we'll offer a word of prayer.
Everything rides on. Waking time with David.
lay down to sleep, and he dreamed. A stairway was set on the ground, and it reached all the way to the sky. Angels of God were going up and going down on it. Then God was right before him, saying, I am God, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. I'm giving the ground on which you are sleeping to you and to your descendants. Your descendants will be as the dust of the earth. They'll stretch from west to east and from north to south. All the families of the earth will bless themselves in you and your descendants. Yes, I'll stay with you. I'll protect you wherever you go, and I'll bring you back to this very ground. I'll stick with you until I've done everything I promised you. Jacob woke up from his sleep. He said, God is in this place truly, and I didn't even know it. He was terrified. He whispered in awe, incredible, wonderful, holy, this is God's house. This is the gates of heaven. Jacob was up first thing in the morning. He took the stone he had used for his pillow and stood it up as a memorial pillar and poured oil over it. He christened the place Bethel, God's house. Dreams. We've all had them. Some are more vivid than others, some with bright colors, some in black and white. Some with people we know, and some with complete strangers. And we've shared our dreams with those around us, just hoping they can help us interpret what they mean. Think back to the last morning you woke up in a cold sweat, groggy from just waking up mid-dream. You can still picture clearly what you were dreaming about, and you may even still feel that you are in that dream. We may rush to our parents or wake a loved one recounting the dream in great detail, trying to understand just what in the world we experienced while we were sleeping, trying to figure out how that dream relates to our world and what we can learn from it. But sometimes dreams are just that. Dreams. They don't have any meaning and simply confuse us. But not so for Jacob. Jacob had a dream in which he gained insight into God and who God was working through and in his life. But before we look at this dream, we need to understand the backstory. Jacob is portrayed as a fugitive fleeing for his life. A vagabond somewhere between a conflict-ridden past and an uncertain future. Immediately before our story began, we find Jacob in a flurry of activity that eventually ends with him heading to Haran. We read that night was falling, and in no particular place, Jacob lays down to sleep. He takes a rock as his pillow and proceeds to have a wild dream interrupting his sleep. Jacob dreams of a ladder that reaches to heaven with God's messengers going up and down on it. Jacob sees the ladder but doesn't have access to it. Rather, God speaks to Jacob where he is, showing God's imminent presence rather than a far away removed God calling from a distance. It is significant that this surprise encounter completely comes from God, breaking into Jacob's state of sleep. And when God speaks to Jacob, God reiterates the promises that were made to Jacob's ancestors, Abraham and Isaac. With this, God emphasizes that God is not only the God of the first and second generation. God makes sure Jacob understands that God is also the God of Jacob. God also promises Jacob that God will be with him, a promise that is even more imperative given the fact Jacob is traveling far away from home, entering an unknown future in an unknown land. A promise that is unique to Jacob is that God promises to bring Jacob back home. A promise that speaks to Jacob's unique circumstances of a man on the run. Jacob then wakes from his dream and realizes that not only does the air around him seem changed by God's presence, but he has been transformed as well. He takes his pillow and turns it into an altar, which marks the place of his life-changing dream. Washington, D.C. was also the site of a life-changing dream. Yet, a different kind of dream. A dream that was the kind futures are made of. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. proclaimed on August 28, 1963, that he had a dream. This wasn't some vivid fantasy that had occurred while he was sleeping. This was a vision he had of the future of America.
He dreamed that his children would not be judged by the color of their skin, but for the content of their character. He had dreamed that the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners would be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. He dreamed of this hope, this faith, that we would be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. And he wanted that freedom to ring from every city and from every hamlet and from every state. This was his dream, which has become a dream deferred. As a committed activist leader, Dr. King was not infallible. He made mistakes, and in a few instances, one could say serious mistakes, yet it was his consistency in the struggle for freedom, his willingness to shoulder the burden in the heat of the day, combined with a generally sound sense of tactics and a demonstrated capacity for human growth, which earned for him the love and respect of millions. Another man as equally revered and loved was Representative John Lewis, whom the nation mourns this weekend. Lewis heard this dream of Dr. King's. Lewis had been born in 1940 to sharecroppers in Alabama at a time Black Americans who had been born into the horrible bondage of slavery still drew breath. At just 17 years of age, Lewis met King, who taught him to be hopeful, to be optimistic, to never get lost in despair, to never become bitter, and to never hate. Lewis and his cohorts, blacks and whites and Jews and others, did not commit acts of violence, but they were often on the receiving end of them. And on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, on Bloody Sunday, he was famously beaten by police. As a tribute to Lewis, our own North Carolina Synod Bishop, Tim Smith, recounted a story. And I quote, "I had the privilege of learning to know him while I served in Atlanta, and our congregation hosted the Lutheran Community MLK Junior Day worship service in January of 2011. As Lewis spoke," that was the contract word, but he preached, "from the center aisle, he told in detail of the incident in 1965 on the Pettus Bridge in Selma. And a little 8-year-old African-American boy walked down the aisle, unscripted, from the back, and stared straight up, face to face with Lewis, and asked, 'Where did they hurt you?' Lewis, before there was any political implication, immediately knelt and took the boy's hand and put it on the top of his head and said, "Feel that gash?" I was sitting right next to that scene, and the little boy said, "Why?" Lewis just said, "Because hate is powerful and evil, but love and God are stronger, young man." Tears in the little boy's eyes, same for Lewis and me and us. In my own privilege-filled life and God's lifelong call and work to relinquish it, this was one of the most powerful inspirations I've ever had. Thank you, God, for the courage, faith, integrity, and witness of John Lewis. And please, God, don't let me get complacent as privilege so naturally and subconsciously insists on doing. End quote. May we never forget the dream. King's dream and Jacob's dream. Jacob's ladder reveals the connection between heaven and earth, divinity and humanity, the uncreated and the created. It appears at every moment in our life, even when we try to run from our life. The ladder Jacob saw was not in a physical location. It was within him. It was not a vision, but a dream. And through Jacob, God's love and connection to us is found deep within ourselves, a place so deep that it is seen in the gift of a dream. We call it Jacob's ladder, but it was not possessed by Jacob. It is God's ladder placed in each one of us. The miracle is not that God shows up and breaks into our lives. That is always happening. The miracle is that we recognize it within ourselves. The ladder is revealed in the lives of fugitives, in the dark places of life where the sun has set, in people who have lived up to their names, in the hard, stony places, in the in-between places, in places we would never have expected. God is surely in this place, and in your place, and in whatever place in the world you find yourself. As the country still reels from the death of George Floyd 7 weeks ago, may we never forget the words of John Lewis, who implored, "If not us, then who? If not now, then when?" May we be inspired to keep the dream alive until all are free and treated as equals. Amen.
Please join us in singing "Dream Small." Oh,
song the way to put your thing. These simple moments change the world.
I would like to take a few minutes to give thanks for you and all the different ways that you are continuing to support the mission and ministry of First Lutheran Church, whether you mail in your check every week, you drop it by the church, you give online. It matters that you do so because this church is still open. We are still serving. We are still loving our neighbors as ourselves. So thank you for your part in that. Let us now take a few minutes to bring our cares and concerns to God who hears us when we pray. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, today we gather in your name, though most of us not in the indoor spaces that have come to symbolize gathering spaces for those seeking truth, justice, and faith. Many of us struggle to feel the sacred or even simple connection through a computer screen, and yet here we are, gathering and struggling and trying to find holiness. Remind us that you are present with us in all our spaces, whether physically in a church building or on our couches in our homes. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
Holy God, we come to you full of grief. We find ourselves going through the stages of grief, denial and anger, bargaining, depression and acceptance many times a day. Grant us the grace and space to grieve for our own losses and the grace and space to allow others to grieve theirs. The displacement of children from their schools and playgrounds, the displacement of black children for generations, the isolation of the elderly today and of the marginalized throughout history, the power of protest or silence. And sit with us in our grief. Lord of the journey, show us the way. Oh God, renew the ties of mutual regard which form our civic life. Send us honest and able leaders. Enable us to eliminate racism and violence so that men and women from different cultures and with differing talents may find with one another their humanity. We pray for our religious leaders and essential workers. We pray for ourselves as we grapple with the lies of a mission. those whose lives have been significantly changed, those who are facing sicknesses, grief, and anxieties that have come with the drastic change to life as we know it. Today, we pray for friends and members of this congregation by name. We pray for Matt, Diana, Sarah, Howard, Rachel, Evelyn, John, Myla, B, and Catherine, Bob and Will, John, Jaretta, Marin, John, Fred, Bob, Ken, Cheryl, George, Howard, Margaret, Grace, Mike, and Hannah. We pray for those we know and can name in the silence of our hearts. And we pray for those we don't know, but we know about, and for those worldwide who suffer. Sustain them with your love and comfort as they continue to heal, to grieve, to figure out life in new ways. Lord of the journey, show us the way. Hear us, loving, living God, as we pray from the depths of our broken hearts. And as we pray together, the prayer Jesus taught us. Our
Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. We are going to move into a time where we can celebrate communion together as a community, although we are separated through screens and in different homes. We can come together in this meal and be one church. Join me in the words to communion. We call this sacred meal by many names, one of them being Holy Communion. Like prayer and worship, eating a meal is a way we commune with God. Aware of God's constant presence and abiding love in our lives. While Jesus and his followers were sharing the Passover meal, he took some bread and prayed, giving thanks to God. There was God, always present with them. Always providing what they needed. Jesus broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this and remember me." Then he lifted a cup and prayed, giving thanks to God. Jesus gave it to them, saying, "This is a new covenant in my blood. Do this and remember me." We remember that God is here in our hands, in our hearts, and in our lives. As we receive this bread and cup, we remember Jesus' life as a sign of God's love, alive in the world and in us. As Paul wrote, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. This meal is a promise that God is always with us. Living in that promise, we strive to be God's life-giving presence for the world. Amen. At this point, you may share communion with those that are worshiping with you in your homes. Join me in our blessing and then our final song. Now we conclude our time of worship, and while so much of the road ahead is uncertain and the path is constantly changing, We know some things are as solid as the ground beneath our feet and the sky above our heads. We know God is love. We know Christ's light endures. We know the Spirit is there. Found in the space between all things, closer to us than our next breath, binding us to each other until we meet again. Amen.
I just want to apologize for any of the technical issues. We're a man down, and it does take a village to put this thing on. So thank you for your patience, and join us in our last song, Alive Again.
I woke up in darkness, surrounded by silence. So where have I gone? I woke to reality, losing its grip on me. Oh, where have I gone? 'Cause I can see the light before I see the sunrise. You called and you shouted, broke through my deafness. Now I'm breathing in, breathing out, I'm alive again. You shattered my darkness, washed away my blindness. Now I'm breathing. Late have I loved you, waited for me, I searched for you. What took me so long? I was looking outside, as if love would ever want to hide. I'm finding I was wrong. Could feel the wind before it hits my skin. You called and you shouted, broke through my deafness. Now I'm breathing in, breathing out, I'm alive again. You shattered my darkness, washed away my. Yes, I want you, and I need you, and I'll do whatever I have to get through, 'cause I love you, and I love you. You called and you shouted, broke through my deafness. Now I'm breathing in, breathing out, I'm alive again.
Thank you for your presence with us this morning. And now go with Christ and go as Christ to love and serve God's world. Thanks be to God.